Saturday, April 13, 2024, Vintage Computer Festival, parking lot A in New Jersey. I didn't have a badge, so here's a plot plan of the area. Interesting. Museum hours, entrance. One day, this is what you get. And a program guide.
So where's the stamp? Like, getting asked for the things to get stamped.
All right, so you guys were out of this process, but I thought you were.
A quick program that changes screen color in basic, and later I'll just have one in assembly language to make a comparison. This is basic. This is what it looks like.
Yeah. As the kids say, it's been a minute.
Wow.
I love that bright flash coming from the hard drive when I did the DM.
There's the CFID in there.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Cheating. I was like, I didn't hear the noise. I just saw a bright flash.
Yeah. Well, you know, with the old hard drives and all that.
Yeah, the chances of having one of those MFM drives work at least for more than an hour is
not great.
I have my first computer, that XT clone, booted it up, like, I had it when it was already 10 years old. Booted it up, like, 10 years later, and it ran once, and then, like, on the next reboot, we got, like, a red flashing light on the hard drive. It was a mini
drive. This, but I stumbled across India by the second generation of the second generation. But what was so funny, what I thought was hilarious, is, and I should have pictures of this because it was such an attempt to try to get filmmakers to come over the board. They actually had some
I'm somebody's like, I have an extra good HD. I'm like, okay. So that's why I get the video on, like, the audio on the headphone jack on the GS.
Wow, these are all the expansion boards?
Was it?
Are these like all the GVP cards?
Yeah, I'm working on the GVP. This one right here is one of the first, one of GVP's first 68040 boards.
Yeah.
It's known as the GeForce 040 for the 3000. And what it had was a 28 or 33 megahertz 68040 chip. Yeah. Had the possibility of 8 megs of memory. This is actually 40 nanosecond non-multiplex DRAM, which was the first foray into that. Very expensive at the time, but it gave great performance.
Yeah, I know it was expensive. I know all the Amiga stuff.
Yep. This was an AmigaNet board that we sold from Hydra for a short period of time. This is the GVP A500 Series 2 PCB, which would go on to the A500.
This is for the hard drive, right?
There's no hard drive currently in at the moment. I didn't bring them all that I wanted to, but that's an A530.
Yeah.
And what that is that's about the same thing as GVP 68030 boards, the latter GeForce boards.
Yeah.
Only it's condensed into a unit that can be a sidecar.
Yeah, I usually have that or something similar to like Bodega Bay or so.
Definitely. Matter of fact, that thing came from somebody's build with a 530 and a 500 inside that case.
Yeah.
I'm getting more boards out over here, but this one is a GVP HC2 of the original series. This one is the front card to an A3001, the first accelerators GVP made. This one is a Spectrum 2824 RTG board that we made. It had 2 meg of memory and a Cirrus Logic based video chip in it. That is our IO extender board, which was a 2-port serial, 1-port parallel, and could also do MIDI interfacing. One of GVP's first hard cards, the Impact series, before the Series 2s came out. And this was one of the last of the original Impact boards. This had up to 8 meg of memory and a SCSI controller all in one. It was not a hard card, though. And if I can dig one out, maybe quick enough, before we grab I don't have anything handy here at the moment, but I'm going to have to go dig in a little bit further for stuff. But I have a Series 2. This guy right here is fairly rare. It was the last revision of the Impact Series 1 sidecar unit for the A500. It actually had 4 SIM sockets for up to 4 meg of memory, and that was basically a lot of memory you could get for a 500 expansion.
Yeah, I had 1 meg with a 512K expansion at that time.
Yeah, down under there, if you look inside, you'll notice it's a very odd accelerator card. That is the Tecmagic 68060 board. It was the last board for the 2000 that Jeff Boyer, who was our engineer, made. It basically is a 66 megahertz 060, up to 128 meg of memory is in there. I haven't gotten any demos going yet, but
like demos as in what? Like Amiga demo, like speed demo?
I was gonna get some demos running on it.
I don't know. Explain to me what this is.
So this is an IBM 1130. It's
yeah.
A mid-1960s mid-range, so small. It's relatively inexpensive. It was about $1,000 a month.
$1,000 per month?
Yeah, you can see actually on the chart there the original lease rates and stuff has that. But, you know, when most computers were many hundreds of thousands of dollars to have one of
what do you do with this? What can you do with this?
It's a 16-bit, you know, binary computer.
Yeah.
It's got the ability to do COBOL and, you know, APL.
How do you program that?
So you would have done it with punch cards.
Oh, and where do you insert them anywhere?
There would have been a separate machine for that.
Oh, okay. Wow.
And you would have also had a line printer and all that stuff.
And what is it doing here? Just
right now, every time the type wall goes, it's incrementing across the.
Wow. I'm just used to the 8-bit systems. I've never seen one of these before in person. I've seen a picture of it.
8-bit was cheap. You know what I mean?
Yeah. A lot smaller, too.
Right.
And if you want this, you might have something else, right? You might have a calculator or something. Still in the corner of the table. When it's time for audits at the end of the fiscal year, we'll choose
practicing our tax money on the computer.
Wow.
Second one will add a 1. So minus 1 and 1 should get a 0, right?
Yeah.
You have to see how the 1130 does addition. So I'm going to single step it through. So doing first memory fetch cycle to get the instruction.
Yep.
8 is add. Then it's in the execute phase. And so it's going to get your first number, put your second number in there. Watch what it does. It does each digit and remembers the carries. So it has to do a cycle, a carry. So it could be as fast as one cycle, or it could take all 16 in this case, until it's rippled. Once there's no more carries, it's done. And you're back in the next one.
That works as like the
as opposed to like two, I think, that these do. I have a handful of these. They are
The Pre 2 got rebranded as an HP device instead of a Palm. On August 18th, so 49 days after the US launch of the touchpad, they discontinued it. Screens off, I mean, show you content. That was part of the platform right from the beginning. And then something that's never been fully duplicated, what WebOS called Synergy, which was sync services that was pervasive throughout the platform. The closest we have today is files integration in iOS. The biggest thing, though, for me as a former web developer is that WebOS pioneered what we now call PWAs, or progressive web apps. So applications developed for WebOS are actually remarkably portable. This is because of the architecture. The initial WebOS architecture was pure Linux at the core. It's a real Linux environment. You can drop to a terminal and run Linux commands. And then the UI layer was pure web with a WebKit rendering engine. Things were kind of stitched together with Dbus. Dbus was wrapped as a service archive. You can get access to the restored SDK if you'd like to try your hand at making apps. I was going to show making an app today, but and then the big daddy of the platform that was released in some markets, but it came right near the end, was the Pre 3. So this is the Pre, this is the Pre 3. The Pre 3 is highly desirable. It was also very functional up until about 2 years ago in the US. In Canada, it still works. In some places in Europe, you can still use a Pre 3. You need an SSL bump proxy to do most web things, but you can actually sync your email and your calendars. You can surf the web selectively. We never got MMS working in the US, but you could text with them. This is a really nice device. It takes forever to boot, but I'll fire it up. The screen was gorgeous on it. This was very much targeting the iPhone and was a really premium device. All right, yeah, questions? Pry it out. You can still buy new old stock batteries, and you can save it. If you plug it in and nothing happens, still be patient. Give it 2 to 3 days to see if the lights start flashing. If the lights start flashing, then start your 5 to 7 day count. I buy them in lots, like a lot of 50 of these things. And if the screen isn't destroyed and the battery is not already a spicy pillow, I have about an 80% success rate at saving them. The first thing I do, whether the screen's cracked or not, is if you look on the app catalog, we have a wanted list in TXT and CSV. So these are apps that are still missing from the app catalog. So the first thing I do is inventory the apps and see if there's anything from the missing list that we need. If there is, I scrape them off. If the hardware is in decent shape, then I put them in consignment or on Tindy, restored with a fresh version of 305, developer unlocked. Activating can be a bit of a pain in the butt because there's no activation servers, though we have a workaround for that. And with kind of the bare necessities you need to get online in 2024. If the screen is shattered and the battery is a spicy pillow, then we throw it out. We responsibly recycle. Did that answer all of the first part of your question?
Sony CyberShot.
That's a really good price for that.
Hey, remember, this is a newer one.
Oh, yeah.
Is it good? You doing it?
No, I'm just looking.
Ooh.
No, but this is these. I have a broken pair of these.
Because
I don't need any more. I have so many.
What are these? I remember that she needs wine and champagne. Oh, we'll get up here at Google Voice.
I have that. Yeah,
I'll have that.
Sony CFS10.
Yeah.
Vintage Computer Festival. Made in Japan. Soundwave Eject Laserbeak. One, two, three, four batteries. Right, left, line in, line out. Walkman. I was a gift from someone's bar mitzvah, 1983. Amiga. Which one is this? 1,000?
It's a box.
Oh, it's 1,000.
It's $100 for the box.
Really?
That's what the sticker says.
Oh, okay.
What am I looking at?
No,
you're looking at something that'll get you banned from flights in the U.S.
I would, yeah, right?
That's its entire purpose.
How much are these hard drives? $15, 250 gig.
It's about filling, right? So, yeah, if you need it for it.
Nah, okay.
Oh, it's the U.S. version of my terminal.
That's the one I
image
have.
Image writer.
Models.
Oh, the 70. Yeah, yeah. We had a rack of those for the cluster app.
I would feel bad buying it without the typewriter.
I'm familiar with that. 486 version.
One has two floppy drives, not really working. Right. Yeah. Yeah. Is it going great for it? I mean, I certainly did not pay that much.
Speaking of Palm.
Yeah, I know. Oh, that looks interesting.
Like a connection or whatever.
Take a pab. Holy yeah.
Transfer text.
Oh, that's smart. Nice. I had no idea what this was.
Yeah, they transfer like a... When you plug it into the PC or Mac, it acts like a keyboard and types it into your... Like it types
into
your computer.
I used one of them in school. Yeah. Reporters
like,
still love those.
I just like the sudden arrival of people who know
what it is.
Oh, yeah, yeah, the office marks.
Where else do you even find one of
those? Where?
8-inch floppies.
Oh my god.
Under my desk.
Yeah. 8-inch floppies. Wait, how are they?
Reed, can you hold that still for a second?
This? Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, what's that?
Games!
Look at that.
Well, how much holy
cow!
Oh, Star Trek. Snake.
Yeah. What architecture, though?
Who knows? Yeah, we're going with IBM.
Is, but it's like
IBM
8.5. Oh, Wang?
Wang.
For Wang. Well, it's a Wang diskette. Who knows what it's for?
Oh, wait, there's more?
Yeah.
Oh, wait. Sorry. This.
Yep, see? Hard sector, 8-inch floppy.
Yep.
What? Hard sector?
So it means like it came from like the factory set up to work on that particular architecture of computer.
Intriguing.
It was totally proprietary. There was no real standards.
Grease Weasel still read them off?
Probably, yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah, it'll get read on like a modern machine, but you just wouldn't be able to put them into like an MSI or something.
Yeah.
Nice. What
was
the price of this box?
No, it's $8 for 30 or something like that.
$30.
I mean, yeah, my brain's. Oh, look, Tomb Raider, what the hell?
Do I want to dick with that many floppies at $30? Yeah, I didn't learn to program until much later. But I didn't have access to any of that kind of hardware when it was current. It was, you know, that was all way above my control.
And my main interest was just later. It's just like games just wound up being boring.
CPU. Was it an AP? Was it like a? Oh, well, that wasn't confirmed. That was earlier.
Yeah, it was Commodore 64.
We had the OKData, whatever the heck it was.
Oh yeah, that color. Was OKMake, color printer.
It was horribly like small for what it was, so it wasn't great. But it's a printer, you got some prints out. It worked okay. A little bit of coke. Something.
It was really cool.
Yeah,
294. Make 20.
That's pretty good.
Solid state. Does it say specify made it? Oh wow, this is cool. Sony, Tokyo, Japan.
Oh, I'm just curious what that is still. It's actually looking at it before.
Yeah, I'm kind of like, I don't know, 80s Arduino.
Oh wow. I just thought it was a microprocessor.
70s, 1978.
Dev kit.
It's obviously like homemade. Someone sees
Sim 1. Oh, wait, Sim 1. Yeah, that's why it sounds like Kim 1.
Which year is this?
It's got a copyright of 78.
Where?
Right down there.
19. Wow, made in USA. Mm.
What are they asking for it?
I don't know. I was just going to try to get a price check on it.
$128 Neo?
Yeah.
What, can you show me more? Or?
It's a one-to-one replica of the Commodore 128 with quality of life improvements and just small fixes. So the original idea was to have a new PCB for the 128.
Yeah.
With all of the factory fixes integrated. So when they manufactured the 128, there were a lot of small changes they did at the factory, like cutting traces, adding wires, etc. That's all integrated on this one.
And what do you need to change for NTSC and PAL?
Between NTSC and PAL, the big two chips would need to be changed.
Wait, that chip?
Yeah. This crystal needs to be changed.
How? Yeah.
And there's a jumper here that you need to set.
How can somebody remove that crystal?
Well, you have to desolder it as it is right now. So as I said, I only sell the bare boards.
Yeah.
So there's no components on them. It's just the PCB.
Oh, so people have to reuse their own chipset.
Yes, correct.
Yeah. Okay.
And source the other components.
Yeah.
So, that's what you would need to do to change in between.
Oh, okay. Well then, so the chips, wait, the crystal?
Yeah, the main clock crystal.
Jumper?
Jumper and the video chip, yeah.
Is that video chip removable?
It is socketed, yes. I don't have the pulley.
Yeah.
But yes.
And on a Commodore 128 original, is it also removable?
Yes.
Also, it's a socket.
On the Commodore 128, all the larger chips are socketed by default.
Yeah.
With the exception of this one in general.
Which one?
The PLA chip.
Yeah.
There are replacement chips for the PLA one.
Yeah. And it has all the ports.
The connectors are this, with the exception of this one.
Yeah.
And the power connector, they're the same as the C64.
Oh.
So they're can also
fairly. Can you see what they look like? Can you turn it around?
Flip it over.
Okay, so when somebody buys it, this is what they're getting.
Yeah, and then you need to solder it up, yeah. I did not solder this. This is actually a customer's machine. So it's certainly a product for hobbies.
Okay. And first, it's available in Netherlands or everywhere in Europe?
I sell them globally on Tindi.
Oh, okay. And where?
On Tindi.
Okay.
I want to thank he's the inventor of S-Video and Sprites. Albert Charpentier.
Thank you. In the morning, like all kids do. And I'd walk out, and there was this test pattern on the screen. Right? And it was just amazing to me, like, how did that get there? I mean, it was just rabbit ears, and how did it get there? And it just fascinated me about how this happened. So just, I think I always was curious, and that was just something I really wanted to know.
People were responsible for that. But, yeah, so it was really the sprites were the hard part of that and how to make that all work.
So you got, I don't know if there's anything else you want to talk about.